So our mission is to improve the quality of life of our people through economic development, but we also hold protecting our land and preserving our resources really near and dear to our heart. We're headquartered in Nome, Alaska. We have 7,600 shareholders. We have not yet enrolled those born after 1971. And we actively pursue resource development to the degree that we can in the region. We have over 2.1 million acres of surface and subsurface estate, and we have 17 member villages. All of our communities are different, with different economies, infrastructure needs, and also different sources of food and water. And like many other communities in Alaska, our communities are faced with challenges in adapting to the new climate because of climate change, and also finding efficient and affordable systems that will encourage sustainability. This map shows the proximity of our region and the lands in our region to Russia. The Diomede Islands are located in the middle of the Bering Strait. And if you see that line that goes straight down the map there, on the one side is Big Diomede, and 2.5 miles away is Little Diomede. One side obviously is owned by Russia, and the other is one of our communities. And Big Diomede, because of the international dateline, is about almost 24 hours ahead of Little Diomede. And this slide also shows how close we are in proximity to Russia. The Bering Strait itself is a relatively uncharted waters, and also the waters there are relatively shallow. And there's a mere 50 miles that separates the United States to Russia, and that's across the Bering Strait. And our region lies on the narrowest point between the North American continent and Eastern Eurasia. You can see from this that the Bering Strait region is at a critical juncture in geographically, and the red line, and I don't know if there's a pointer on this, but you should be able to see it pretty readily, is the Northern Sea Route, and the blue line there is the Northwest Passage. This is a polar view of the Arctic, and the red area there identifies our area. And I think it should be clear to everyone that an ice-free Arctic has major strategic and economic ramifications for the Arctic, for our communities, and also for global shipping. Vessels will someday be able to navigate the Arctic Ocean. Transarctic shipping routes could shorten distances between northern Europe and northern China by up to 4,000 nautical miles and reduce shipping times by up to 2 weeks. There are geopolitical issues that we need to deal with. You know, for a while there were a number of articles that these Russian political folks and scholars were writing saying that, you know, the sale of Alaska to the United States was not legal, and that we really should be reabsorbed back into Russia. In terms of the government itself, President Putin's new military strategy emphasizes protection of Russian interests in the Arctic. The restoration of the Russian military infrastructure in the Arctic began in 2012. In recent years, Russia has unveiled a new Arctic command, 4 new Arctic Brigade combat teams, plans for 14 new operational airfields, 16 deep water ports, and 40 icebreakers with an additional 11 in the development. And we have one working icebreaker for the Arctic, and the other one is disabled. And I know that Senator Murkowski has been working really, really hard to ensure that we have more than one working icebreaker. And I'd like to thank her for that. And Russia is also building bases, refurbishing their submarine fleet, and ordering helicopters that are specifically designed to fly in the frozen air of the Arctic. And they're doing this all the while assuring us that these capabilities have only defensive application and often serve a dual purpose in supporting other government objectives, such as enabling resource development, supporting shipping along the Northern Sea Route, or contributing to Russia's broader search and rescue capability. They also assert that none of these developments present a real threat to Canada or the North American Arctic. So what are Russia's plans for the Arctic? I think it's pretty clear, and probably everyone knows, that they have remilitarized a number of bases. They just finished equipping 6 new military bases throughout the Arctic in a move to recreate their military presence to levels that it had during the Cold War. And they plan to involve the opening of 10 Arctic search and rescue stations, as I said before, 16 deepwater ports, 14 airfields, and 10 air defense radar stations across their periphery. Russian troops will be deployed in the Arctic by 2018, equipped with all of the necessary high-tech weaponry, according to a high-ranking Russian minister. And a series of smaller bases would also be created on Wrangel Island, on the eastern coast of Chukotka, on the Kuril Islands, and at Cape Schmidt. And there's also some discussion that they are remilitarizing Big Diomede Island. They also estimate that they will have constructed 6 airfields by the end of 2017. In March of 2014, their Western Military District began preparing housing blocks and infrastructure to house approximately 3,000 soldiers from Russia's Northern Fleet. The new fleet will track military, maritime, and air movements and activities, support development in the Arctic and far north, and search for threats from the West. Oops, sorry. So what are the U.S. needs for the Arctic? And I'd like to preface this by saying that Congress is looking to cut $54 billion from the budget. But, you know, I think that we all recognize the U.S. has national security concerns that need to be addressed. We need strategic ports in the Arctic. We need missile defense because of North Korea and other countries. We need icebreakers. We need to ensure that the freedom of the seas exists in the Arctic. And we also need telecom and domain awareness. The Coast Guard has said that it needs 6 icebreakers to cover the responsibilities at the North and South Poles, and they each cost $1 billion to build. Senator Sullivan said recently that the highways of the Arctic are icebreakers. Russia has superhighways, and we have dirt roads with potholes. And newly appointed Secretary of Defense James Mattis addressed the Arctic during his confirmation hearings. And he said that the Arctic is key strategic terrain. Russia is taking aggressive steps to increase its presence there. He said that he would prioritize the development of an integrated strategy for the Arctic. And this was in response to a written question that Senator Sullivan had posed to him. We do have major concerns for our infrastructure needs, and that is that with no offshore oil and gas development, how do you justify the costs associated with infrastructure that we need to develop and the activity that would otherwise have been there that really isn't? The The U.S. estimates that about 15% of the world's remaining oil, or up to 30% of its natural gas deposits and about 20% of its liquefied natural gas, are stored in the Arctic seabed. And additionally, we recognize that receding ice would enable faster global shipping routes. And recently, the Wall Street Journal noted that by 2030, the Northern Sea Route will be passable to shipping for 9 months a year, and that the route could cut down travel time between Europe and East Asia by as much as 60% compared to current routes through the Panama or Suez canals. This map shows Port Clarence itself, which is a natural deep water port and harbor in our region. The harbor itself is protected, and it's a location where vessels have overwintered in frozen ice since the early commercial whaling days. It's a narrow spit that has not suffered the effects of climate change with erosion, and instead is experiencing land accretion. And it sits at about 20 feet above sea level at its highest point. If you were to build infrastructure at Port Clarence to reach minus 35 feet, which would accommodate most vessels other than tankers, you would need to build a causeway or dock less than 1/10 of a mile offshore. And there are two locations at Port Clarence where such a causeway could be established, and both locations are on the side of the spit, sheltered by the spit itself. This is an aerial view of Port Clarence, and in 1962, the lands at Port Clarence were withdrawn for use as a Loran station, and at one time, the Loran station had the tallest structure in Alaska, and it was demolished in 2010, and the people of my region at some point tried to convince the Coast Guard not to demolish the Loran station because they actually used it as a navigation guide when they were out fishing and engaging in other subsistence and commercial activities. We were successful in having legislation that would authorize the transfer to us in 2016. And it would also authorize transfer of lands at Port Clarence to the state of Alaska and the U.S. Coast Guard. So we stand poised to meet the Arctic future at the gateway to the Arctic, which is the Bering Strait. And we're hopeful that if Port Clarence is developed, that it will provide economic development opportunities and jobs in our region for our people, for our region, Alaska, and also benefit the Arctic. I always like to show slides from home. This is an older slide from home. And you can see that and know that subsistence is still a really important part of our communities. The other day, I talked to my 90-year-old mother for a while, and she was really excited about the fact that she had been able to go out ice fishing the other day. And she was talking about the trout and whitefish that she caught with plans to give the whitefish to my sister, who would then use it to make a gudok. This is an old family photo, and I think that family is really important. These are mainly the Ivanov family. We are cousins to the Ivanov through my dad's grandmother and their grandmother. This is a family photo, and if I knew how to work this pointer thing, you could see my mother in the photo, and she's the woman with the little cute curl up above her head. And then her grandmother, great-grandmother, and cousin. This is another family photo. It's five generations of my family. To the far, it would be to your far left, is my great-great-grandmother, Lena Williams, my great-grandmother, Mielrach Marian Ganangnan, who was the eldest daughter of the last traditional chief of Yinlaklit, my grandmother, Martha Nanauk, my mother, Betty Anagic, and my oldest sister, Rose. And I think just to close in showing the importance of our region, Chief Olagana, who my great-great-grandmother was his half-sister, is shown with General Eisenhower. And I think that our region continues to have importance and significance, and we look forward to moving forward with economic development and other opportunities.